You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.
A year of challenge. A year that stretches patience. A year of hope, symbolized by a yellow ribbon.
This is an ABC News special. The Iran crisis. America held hostage. Day 58.
No one will easily forget how the 80s began. American hostages in Iran gave birth to a national mania and to a television program that reminded us nightly of our plight. America held hostage. Americans were shocked and angered. How could a third world country headed by a religious fanatic bring a superpower to its knees? Why couldn't we just get them out? We found that it was a very complicated affair and that terrorism has many faces. On November 4th, 1979, student radicals seized the U.S. Embassy in Tehran, taking over 60 Americans hostage. Ayatollah Khomeini, Iran's fundamentalist Muslim leader, refuses to release the Americans. Like most momentous events, the hostage crisis has its roots in history. Our involvement began with this man, the Shah of Iran, when the CIA helped stage a coup d'etat and place Mohammad Reza Pahlavi on the throne. For 37 years, the Shah kept Iran staunchly in the Western political orbit and relentlessly modernized his oil-rich country. Internal dissent was quelled in the streets and in the torture chambers by Savak, the Shah's secret police. Happy to have an anti-communist policeman in the vital oil center of the Persian Gulf, successive U.S. governments overlooked Iran's growing internal dissent.
Iran, because of the great leadership of the Shah, is an island of stability in one of the more troubled areas of the world.
But that was changing fast. By late 1978, Iranians were no longer tolerating the Shah's excesses. Demonstrators were shot in the streets. More and more protesters waved pictures of the Shah's most powerful enemy. In France, Khomeini was a virtual government in exile, fueling the religious revolution at home.
Oh, my people, do not hesitate. You have the power. Do not be afraid of these superpowers.
Realizing that he had lost his grip on his country, the Shah and his family fled. On February 1st, 1979, Khomeini returned to a tumultuous, emotional welcome. The country was his. In October, against the strong advice of the State Department, President Carter allowed the Shah to enter the country for cancer treatment. That was all the fuel the student radicals in Tehran needed.
The U.S. Embassy in Tehran has been invaded and occupied by Iranian students. The Americans inside have been taken prisoner, and according to a student spokesman, will be held as hostages until the deposed Shah is returned from the United States.
While the Iranians burned an American flag in front of the embassy, they said the takeover had the express blessing of the Ayatollah Khomeini. In return for their American hostages' freedom, they're demanding the United States give up the deposed Shah of Iran from his hospital bed in New York.
Aside from wanting the Shah back, the militants demanded the return of his vast wealth, admission that the United States had harmed Iran, and an agreement not to intervene in its internal affairs. The demands were unacceptable to Washington. The hostages were caught in the middle of a dangerous political game. All they could do was wait.
Day 59. At the American Embassy in Tehran, 1980 begins as 1979 ended. Nothing new. Hostages still in captivity.
1980. America faces the new year embroiled in the hostage crisis. The long wait brings anger and frustration, but it also unites the country in a shared spirit of hope.
I don't have to look very far at all to see just how wonderful this country and our people really are. This is the true meaning of America.
For the families of the hostages, the waiting is more difficult.
When you have to face the fears, the uncertainties, and the worries.
Other Americans turn their anger into comic relief.
Someday soon, Khomeini, you'll burn one flag too many. Uncle Sam's got his pride, you're about to feel his clout.
One of the first signs of hope for an end to the crisis comes just after the new year, when UN Secretary General Kurt Waldheim goes to Tehran. His goal is to meet with the hostages and with Khomeini.
The purpose of my visit is, of course, in the first place, to pave the way for a solution of the crisis.
In a charade that will characterize most meetings between foreigners and Iranians for the whole year, Waldheim is shuttled between competing Iranian politicians, but never achieves his goals.
We had a very extensive exchange of views on the different aspects of the problem.
His trip is a total failure and a setback for the United States.
Well, the basic problem is the return of the Shah and his wealth, and I hope you'll be able to solve that. That's a basic problem as far as we're concerned.
As Carter wrestles with the stalemate in Tehran, another foreign policy wild card is being played in Moscow. The Soviet Union takes advantage of America's distraction with the hostages and launches a full-scale invasion of neighboring Afghanistan, attempting to install a pro-communist government. For America, the Soviet action further complicates the already tense situation. Afraid that the Russians might also invade Iran to gain its Persian Gulf seaports, the U.S. now alters its strategy for getting the hostages out.
Verbal condemnation is not enough. The Soviet Union must pay a concrete price.
Carter's response to Moscow is swift, but ultimately futile. He cuts off high technology sales, imposes a grain embargo, and ends cultural exchanges. As with Iran, America must rely not on a military solution, but on lengthy diplomatic efforts to solve the Afghan problem.
The Soviets, a major departure from anything they've done since the Second World War, have now exhibited a willingness to use their military forces beyond their own borders in a massive invasion of Afghanistan. The reaction that I have taken to these steps are appropriate and I believe and hope adequate. We must convince the Soviet Union through peaceful means peaceful means that they cannot invade an innocent country with impunity and they must suffer the consequences of their action.
The slow progress leaves Carter open to criticism. When Republican candidates debate in Iowa, kicking off the 1980 presidential campaign, the gloves come off.
Unless the president has a specific agreement with Canada, Australia, and Argentina that they're not going to rush in and fill the void that we're leaving by the failure to sell 17 million metric tons of grain to the Soviet Union, then I think the president's made a mistake.
I think the farmer has been made a scapegoat again of the consistent foreign policy failures of this administration.
He devastated the American farmer. He made the farmer the scapegoat for past failures in foreign policy. Didn't hurt the Russians a bit. He took a poke at the Russian bear and knocked out the American farmer.
On the campaign trail, Governor Ronald Reagan joins the fray.
The farmers therefore have every reason to expect that in the long run, it will be they and not the Russians who will suffer from the grain embargo.
On the Democratic side, presidential challenger Ted Kennedy also throws a 1-2 punch.
The grain embargo will not be effective, that the results of the grain embargo will be to penalize the farmer.
Kennedy's repeated attacks force Carter on the defensive.
Senator Kennedy insinuated that because we had given medical treatment to the Shah, that somehow the seizure of our own hostages was not the fault of the terrorist who took them, but the fault of the United States. Senator Kennedy has also said that the invasion of Afghanistan by the Soviet Union was not only not very serious, but that somehow or another the Soviets were not the culpable party, but the United States was at fault and somehow caused or contributed to the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan.
The Soviets are on everybody's mind, especially 20 young American hockey players in the Winter Olympics at Lake Placid, New York.
We're a young team, we're the youngest Olympic hockey team ever, and a lot of guys don't have the experience that, say, the Soviet Union or Team Sweden or even the Czechoslovakian team has. As far as the odds of us winning, they're great. They're very great. I think, though, with the home crowd and the advantage as far as the youth and enthusiasm that we're going to play with, I think it's going to help us. But as far as if you had to pick us, I think it would probably be picked fifth or fourth.
Making too many good saves. Eruption!
By the time of the showdown with the powerful Soviet team, the U.S. had surprised everyone and stood in second place.
5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes! Unbelievable.
But there will be no highlights of the summer games this year.
I have notified the Olympic Committee that with Soviet invading forces in Afghanistan, neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team to Moscow.
Giving the Soviets a deadline to withdraw their troops or risk a boycott, Carter is firm. Congress and the American people overwhelmingly approve. Not all the athletes agree.
Politics shouldn't intervene in sports. And also, I just don't see any clear evidence that this is something that's going to only hurt the Soviet Union. I think it hurts the United States. It hurts our international prestige in some ways, I think, not to be present at an Olympics. And it's unfortunate for the athletes involved too, you know.
I grudgingly accept the boycott. But I say grudgingly because the government has never helped us in amateur sports. They have always denied our international importance in the political arena. And now when they need us, they're going to use us because they have the clout and we must bow to what they say.
In the end, America and 55 of her allies stay away from the Moscow Olympics. And Russia continues to send even more troops to Afghanistan. At the arcade, kids find new fads. In 1980, video games are the rage, swallowing quarters by the millions, launching a new entertainment industry, and setting the pace for the world's infatuation with high-tech electronic gadgets.
From the Greek kalos
teen starlet Brooke Shields raises eyebrows and controversy in ads for Calvin Klein jeans. Looking tame by today's standards, some TV stations find them too hot to handle and boycott the ads.
I've been Calvinized.
Cameras on unmanned spacecraft Voyager 1 capture the planet Saturn, getting close enough to discover hundreds of new rings, including two that are braided together, like the double helix DNA molecule that is the foundation of human life.
Nobody knows about this meeting tonight, not even our other friend.
A different kind of camera is used by FBI agents posing as representatives of Arab sheikhs who offer cash in exchange for legislative favors.
Okay.
Secretly videotaped taking cash, one senator, six congressmen, and six others are convicted in the Abscam scandal.
What?
From Hollywood, the most popular films of the year are Kramer vs. Kramer, which features two superstars, Dustin Hoffman and Meryl Streep. The Empire Strikes Back, second of George Lucas's Star Wars trilogy. And Ordinary People, which marks Robert Redford's debut as a director. And then there is Mount St. Helens.
Well, dear God, whoever finds us, I don't know. I can't see this, I'm sure it's too dark. I've left the car behind. First of the gear, we got one magazine. And as you can tell probably from this picture, I'm walking towards the only light I can see on top of a ridge. I can hear the mountain behind me rumbling. It's an enormous mud and water, so I came down and washed out the road. I never really thought I'd believe this or say this, but at this moment, I honest to God believe I'm dead.
Caught in the middle of one of the most dramatic explosions in America, the Mount St. Helens eruption takes everyone by surprise. TV cameraman Dave Crockett, filming at the base of the mountain, finds himself in a race for his life.
My God, I didn't realize how badly I wanted to live. Oh, I wanted to live so bad. It's completely black in here again. I can't see a foot in front of my face. The ash is coming down very heavy on me. It's either gotten very dark in here, or it's a horrible thought, or else I'm blind. I don't know what's in this stuff. I can feel it falling on me. Can't see anything. God, I want to live. You know, Shram, you were right. Never should have come up here. You were right.
11 hours later, he is rescued by helicopter. With a gigantic blast, 500 times more powerful than the atomic bomb dropped at Hiroshima, ash and steam are hurled 60,000 feet into the sky. Shockwaves and 50-mile-per-hour mudslides level fir trees in an area 120 miles wide. Day turns to night as nearly 7 inches of volcanic ash descends on communities 175 miles away. Fish, game, and people perish. And 2 days later, as far away as New York City, the effects of Mount St. Helens are obvious. Even farther away, in Iran, the hostage crisis continues, and everything the U.S. tries to free them turns to ashes too. In March, a UN commission is blocked from seeing the hostages by feuding Iranian politicians. Victims of the Shah's secret police, Savak, are paraded before the commission as proof of the Shah's brutality. But in the end, nothing is accomplished. Hoping to curry favor with Iran, Carter attempts to keep the recuperating Shah in Panama so he can be extradited to Tehran for trial. But one day before the legal papers can be served, the Shah flees to the safety of Egypt. The U.S. is left empty-handed again. As Carter's popularity plunges, he gets more desperate. Frustrated by failure, he imposes sweeping economic sanctions, freezes Iranian assets in U.S. banks, and expels all Iranian diplomats within 24 hours. Then, after weeks of inaction, Carter stumbles again.
With the steady unraveling of authority in Iran and the mounting dangers that are posed to the safety of the hostages themselves, and the growing realization that their early release was highly unlikely, I made a decision to commence the rescue operations plans. Equipment failure in the rescue helicopters made it necessary to end the mission. As our team was withdrawing after my order to do so, two of our American aircraft collided on the ground following a refueling operation in a remote desert location in Iran. There was no fighting, there was no combat, but to my deep regret, eight of the crewmen of the two aircraft which collided were killed, and several other Americans were hurt in the accident. We have been disappointed before. We will not give up in our efforts. To the families of those who died and who were wounded, I want to express the admiration I feel for the courage of their loved ones and the sorrow that I feel personally for their sacrifice. It was my decision to attempt the rescue operation. It was my decision to cancel it when problems developed in the placement of our rescue team for a future rescue operation. The responsibility is fully my own. In the aftermath of the attempt, we continue to hold the government of Iran responsible for the safety and for the early release of the American hostages who have been held so long.
He must know something we don't. He must have had reasons for sending this team in. He may have felt it was the time to try it. And certainly had it been successful, it would have been wonderful.
I am very angry that the president of our country would do something so stupid. I believe it is time that the American people see that President Carter and his advisors are not capable of handling this crisis.
It demonstrates to me that the government of the United States has become so desperate due to its inability to understand the nature of the crisis in Iran that right now I think they are willing to sacrifice the hostages and sacrifice more American lives and Iranian lives in order to prove their John Wayne mentality.
Well, I like some cocaine every now and then, sit around my friends and get high. I mean, I enjoy that.
Think about dying now, ain't you? Yeah, I'm thinking about that, I'm thinking about that. You didn't think about it when you was eating all that pork.
Back in Los Angeles, actor-comedian Richard Pryor sets himself on fire while freebasing cocaine and suffers burns over 50% of his body. His recovery is rapid, and Pryor returns to a successful screen career, but not to drugs.
I really feel... I don't go to church or nothing, but I feel born again. I feel like God has given me a second chance at life.
Elsewhere in the world, after 90 years of white rule, the African country of Rhodesia becomes Zimbabwe. In a ceremony presided over by Britain's Prince Charles, Robert Mugabe is sworn in as Prime Minister. After 10 years of tension due to tribal war and racial discrimination, Mugabe calls for reconciliation. Our abuse of planet Earth will become a recurrent theme throughout the 80s. The severe problems at one town in New York are just the beginning.
I want to move into my new house. I want to start living again. I want to forget about the baby I lost. I'll never forget the baby I lost, but I just want to put it in my past. I can't because I'm reminded every day by these idiots!
Residents of Love Canal in Niagara Falls reach the simmering point at a town meeting, focusing on the poisoning of their environment.
Can you tell me when I'm not going to lose any more children because one is already dead? Please tell me those things. That's what I want to know.
For over 40 years, Hooker Chemical Corporation dumped over 80 toxic substances at Love Canal. And the poisons are now seeping into the homes built over the deposit site.
Well, we have got abnormalities in our chromosomes, and we've known it all along that on our street alone there has been already 8 cases of cancer on a 15-house street.
As serious illnesses rise, panic sets in, and home values nosedive. The community has raised its voice for years, but government fails to respond until now.
It's election year. We didn't see nobody for 2 years except for when Kerry wanted to be reelected. And he come down and he got the people out of first ring. And then when he wanted his $500 million bond issue passed, he decided to come up with $5 million for us. And now Carter wants to be reelected and all of a sudden EPA is in there.
How does that make you feel?
Like we're guinea pigs. We're expendable.
Totally frustrated, angry residents take a lesson from the Iran crisis and hold 2 Environmental Protection Agency employees hostage, forcing President Carter into emergency sessions.
I have told the White House, and this is upon your approval, that we will allow the 2 EPA representatives to leave, but if we do not have a disaster declaration Wednesday by noon, then what they have seen here today is just a Sesame Street picnic in comparison. After what you heard this past weekend, you've got the nerve to sit there and vote no?
They're animals.
Oh, I hate all of you. I hate you.
But the next night, the city council turns a deaf ear to the plight of their neighbors and refuses to help.
Our little Julie was stillborn. The loss of our child may be a direct result to the chemicals. Please don't allow this to happen to anyone else before you get them out.
However, Carter's emergency relief comes through the next day.
Today, the federal government and the state of New York are setting in motion an action plan to temporarily relocate over 700 families in Love Canal area of Niagara Falls. We believe that this action is necessary to protect the health and to protect the welfare of these residents from exposure to toxic waste deposited in the area by Hooker Chemical Company.
You have an emergency declaration from the President of the United States, which means you will get temporary housing free up to 1 year from the time you move in.
Yeah, but what happens to our house if we have to leave?
Well, we're trying to negotiate that for you now. I said I didn't have any easy answers for you. We've just...
The logistics for moving 700 families is a formidable task, but not as difficult as overcoming the long-term fury. In the end, what once had been a vibrant community becomes a ghost town. And what does this mean for Love Canal?
I'm not sure it would ever be safe to live there again. I think we've destroyed that area.
For 6 months in 1980, thousands of boats shuttle between the Cuban port of Mariel and South Florida, ferrying over 125,000 Cuban refugees fleeing Castro's tyranny. many families are joyously reunited. But a large criminal element unloaded from Castro's jails become a big headache for the police.
Probably the most significant problem that's occurred recently has been the Cuban refugee influx of personnel during the last 6 months, where many of the refugees that did come over from the Mariel boatlift were involved in criminal activity in Cuba, the same type of criminal activity that we would have put people in jail for here in the United States.
Miami is not prepared for the flood of refugees, and the Freedom Flotilla strains all of the city's resources.
I personally think it's going to be bad for Miami. Either they should be spread throughout the United States or they should be given back to Cuba.
At the same time, Miami is the scene of another incident. This one rising from internal pressures.
Pigs out here. These policemen are pigs. These guys have done their dirt. They have taken McDuffie. They've killed him. These people asked for justice. They've taken Johnny Jones. They've crucified him under white jury. This stuff doesn't make sense. These people want justice, and I don't blame them.
The most devastating race riots since the 1960s are triggered here after an all-white jury acquits four white policemen of the fatal beating of a black business executive. Arthur McDuffie had only committed a traffic violation. It is May, and for 2 days and nights, frustrated Miami erupts in violence, leaving 18 dead, 300 injured, and $200 million in property damage. At the core of the trouble is the economic and social isolation blacks feel as Miami's Latino and white populations grow and prosper.
I met with President Carter just this past Friday for an hour, and told him in no uncertain terms that in my judgment, Miami was going to explode. I saw all the elements of explosion in the city. I talked with Senator Childs, Senator from Florida, just today. How can he bring into this community 13,000 fewer summer jobs, 7,000 fewer public service jobs, while there are 50,000 Cubans and another 20,000 Haitians who are here on the backs of this city? We must gain some emergency legislative relief for Cubans and Haitians. We must provide more jobs and training as alternatives to welfare and despair.
The grueling months of presidential primaries end in June, with Carter beating back Ted Kennedy's challenge.
As I stand here before you, I have one deep feeling in my heart, and that is thanksgiving to all of you who turned what 8 months ago was a prediction of absolute defeat into a wondrous victory tonight.
I reject completely what Mr. Carter said last year, that there's a malaise in the spirit of this country. There is no malaise in the spirit of this country. It's just Mr. Carter.
Kennedy's bitter attacks weaken Carter's stature in the party. After winning the huge California primary, he vows to fight Carter at the convention in New York. The showdown continues. Republican frontrunner, former actor and governor of California, Ronald Reagan, breezes through the primaries with a few colorful moments.
Excuse me, Governor Reagan. Would the sound man please turn Mr. Reagan's mic off for the moment? Would you turn that microphone off, please?
I am paying for this microphone.
I just want to set the record.
Only George Bush proves to be a serious contender. But Reagan racks up enough early delegate votes to assure the nomination will be his. The Republicans look forward to a show of unity at their convention in Detroit.
You must know the trouble that she's in.
Elsewhere in Detroit, another drama unfolds. For years, the Chrysler Corporation has seen its sales drop rapidly, and the company is near its end. But feisty chairman Lee Iacocca goes to Washington and asks Congress to back the largest loan guarantee package in history.
What's affected our plan considerably is the 20% interest rates, or 19, have really turned our dealers off on buying their cars for December.
I certainly hope and pray it works. I'd like to see Chrysler make it. I think it's very important that they do make it. At the same time, I think this is a dangerous, bad precedent.
He succeeds, getting $1.5 billion in loans.
Chrysler is back in the business of selling cars and trucks.
A conversation between Frank Sinatra and Lee Iacocca.
What we've got established.
Then Iacocca goes on TV as company pitchman and ends up a star himself. His performance spawns a new era of the celebrity business executive. Chrysler recovers with its new K car. And Iacocca becomes an American hero. The race for the White House is a tale of two cities. In Detroit, Republicans hold a love fest in Reagan's honor as they unite to capture the presidency. In New York, the Democratic Party comes together, but real unity is hard to find. The big question for the Republicans is who will Reagan choose for a running mate? Some favor ex-president Gerald Ford. But in the end,
with a deep sense of commitment, I accept your nomination to serve as our party's candidate for vice president on a ticket headed by the leader of our party and the next president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. I accept.
The Carter-Mondale ticket is set, but it's Teddy Kennedy who takes the convention by storm.
There were some who said we should be silent about our differences on issues during this convention, but the heritage of the Democratic Party has been a history of democracy. We fight hard because we care deeply about our principles and purposes. We did not flee this struggle. We welcome the contrast with the empty and expedient spectacle last month in Detroit, where no nomination was contested, no question was debated, and no one dared to raise any doubt or dissent.
In his acceptance speech, Reagan blasts the opposition, and the delegates are delirious.
Can anyone look at the record of this administration and say, well done? Can anyone compare the state of our economy when the Carter administration took office with where we are today and say, keep up the good work? Can anyone look at our reduced standing in the world today and say, let's have four more years of this? I believe the American people are going to answer these questions as you've answered them in the first week in November, and their answer will be, no, we've had enough.
Moments of Carter's acceptance speech are received with mixed emotions.
When Soviet troops invaded Afghanistan, we moved quickly to take action. I suspended some grain sales to the Soviet Union. I called for draft registration. We joined wholeheartedly with the Congress.
Registration quickly drowned out, as you hear, by the
Carter supporters, but there was an adverse reaction on the draft registration issue.
Now the hard campaigning begins. Political process in the U.S., political unrest in Central America. Archbishop Oscar Romero, one of El Salvador's most respected church leaders, is assassinated by rebels in a stark prelude to a decade of violence. 6 days later, 30,000 mourners pack a plaza for Romero's funeral. Snipers open fire on the crowd, killing 26 and injuring 200. The political infighting is so complicated in El Salvador that no one knows if the killers are left-wing or right-wing. In Paraguay, Anastasio Somoza, ousted president of Nicaragua, is assassinated. Having been exiled by the Marxist Sandinista government, he dies when six men using machine guns and a bazooka ambush his limousine. Argentinian terrorists sympathetic to the left-wing Sandinistas are blamed. In an event that will have powerful repercussions throughout the decade, the first blow against the Soviet Union's iron grip on Eastern Europe is struck by Polish workers, led by an electrician named Lech Walesa. When the communist government raises food prices, workers across Poland stage massive strikes in protest. In the Baltic port of Gdansk, workers go even further, demanding a national independent trade union. At first, the government refuses. Then, after more crippling strikes, gives in. Solidarity is born, with Walesa at the helm.
Sir, the session was good. Good.
The sides are set, and the stakes are enormous. The Polish economy is headed for disaster as the long negotiations begin. Tensions increase when the Soviets mass tanks at the Polish border. But Moscow backs down, and the first non-communist trade union within the Soviet bloc becomes reality. In an interview with ABC correspondent Peter Jennings, Walesa speaks out.
In a small union office, Walesa told us the union was not being provocative, the Soviet Union was. This is our country, he said, and we'll be here whoever likes it or not. I am not afraid of the Russians, he said. We are not cowards. We can solve our problems by ourselves.
Walesa becomes a hero and galvanizes the country, becoming a symbol of the hopes of Poland to throw off Soviet chains. The struggle between freedom and domination is just beginning. But America cannot loosen the chains on the hostages in Iran. When the Shah dies in July, and then when Iraq invades Iran in September, starting a war that will keep the Persian Gulf in turmoil for 8 years, hopes are raised that the Iranian leaders will release the 52 Americans. But again, those hopes are dashed when Khomeini issues new demands. After nearly a year in captivity, the hostage crisis is a crucial issue in the quest for the White House. The candidates battle it out on the campaign trail and in debate.
And the final judgment about the future of a nation, war, peace, involvement, reticence, thoughtfulness, care, consideration, concern, has to be made by the man in the Oval Office. It's a lonely job, but with the involvement of the American people in the process with an open government, the job is a very gratifying one.
Next Tuesday is election day. Next Tuesday, all of you will go to the polls. You'll stand there in the polling place and make a decision. I think when you make that decision, it might be well if you would ask yourself, are you better off than you were 4 years ago? Is it easier for you to go and buy things in the stores than it was 4 years ago? Is there more or less unemployment in the country than there was 4 years ago? Is America as respected throughout the world as it was? Do you feel that our security is as safe, that we're as strong as we were 4 years ago? And if you answer all of those questions yes, why then I think your choice is very obvious as to who you'll vote for. If you don't agree, if you don't think that this course that we've been on for the last 4 years is what you would like to see us follow for the next four, then I could suggest another choice that you have.
And on November 4th, exactly 1 year after the hostages were seized, Americans overwhelmingly make that choice.
I consider the trust that you have placed in me sacred, and I give you my sacred oath that I will do my utmost to justify your faith.
Reagan wins by a landslide, ousting a sitting president.
For so many years, you can play baseball for so many years, and you can play football for so many years, and you can run for so many years. But there comes a day when God takes the leanness from the body.
Good night, folks, and good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are.
I will concentrate on domestic achievements. I don't want to talk about our foreign achievements, except that I pray every night that Henry Kissinger don't give the Russians the Washington Monument. He's given them every goddamn thing else.
I'm always wonderful at math.
Yes, but tonight you were especially good.
Well, when I'm good, I'm very good. But when I'm bad, I'm better.
At least so far as dissenting opinions are concerned, their quality improves with the age of the judge.
This poor fellow is past help. You better report this to the sheriff.
Me look around, Kimasemi.
Put John in the back of a police car and took off. Yoko was with him.
Good shot.
He didn't look very good. He got shot at least four times, I guess. One officer was said two times. Other people were saying as many as six, but I heard four shots.
Mr. Lennon died as a result of multiple gunshot wounds of the chest and left shoulder. He was struck by four bullets.
Again, a second anniversary that we have spent apart. Maybe with a little luck, we'll spend our silver wedding anniversary together next year.
The year winds to a close. The holiday season nears, and on day 416 of the crisis, the hostages are spending their second Christmas in Tehran.
Come ye to
You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.